In this sequence, we will be looking at various bee families within the Hymenoptera order. Hymenoptera includes wasps, ants, bees, and sawflies. These insects exhibit varying levels of sociality. These levels are dubbed solitary, communal, quasi-social, semi-social, and eusocial. Solitary bees don't cooperate with other bees for their survival. Communal female bees will help each other construct nests. Quasi-social bees will help construct nests and care for young. However, each female lays its own eggs. Semi-social means all that and the emergence of a worker caste which does not reproduce. And finally, eusocial species exhibit all of these semi-social characteristics of cooperative brood care and a division of labor into reproductive and non-reproductive castes, as well as there being an overlap of generations. For example, with the honeybees, a queen may live several years, while the worker bees typically don't last longer than several weeks, with the exception of bees that successfully overwinter. We will start with what are commonly referred to as sweat bees, the Halictidae family. A widespread species, Agapostomon veriscens, is ubiquitous in the Western Hemisphere, and they are a communal bunch. The females will share a burrow entrance while having their own little apartments to themselves. This design helps to defend against parasitic wasps. The Agochlorini genus, Greek for exceedingly green, nests primarily in the ground, some in rotting wood. These are pictures of two different species among the blue chicory flowers in the lower garden. Halictus ligatus has a defined jaw, which you can see here, and the entire Halictus genus has characteristically well-defined stripes on the abdomen, as we saw with Halictus parallelus in the video introduction. This genus is primitively eusocial. This means that there is not a permanent and rigid division of labor. Like many social species, the degree of sociality is determined by the climate and environment. Some species are solitary in one bioregion and eusocial in another. Difficult to see here, the Lasioglossum genus has a thorax with a subtle metallic sheen. Most often I've seen these more bluish sweat bees down at the creek, while the green sweat bees I've more often encountered in the gardens. Sweat bees release a pheromone when they find a sweaty human to lick. Killing these tiny bees will simply serve to release more pheromone upon your body, attracting more bees to you. In my experience, it is best to leave them alone as they lightly tickle your skin. If you accidentally pinch one, they will give you a weak little sting. These bees collect sweat and tears, tears having a higher protein content than sweat, as any experienced bodybuilder knows. The Apidae family, which comprises honeybees, bumblebees, carpenter bees, and many of your other favorite bees, is easily the most economically important family of bees. These insects provide a ton of labor in the form of pollination services. The entire U.S. almond crop is dependent on commercial beekeepers across the nation shipping their beehives by the truckload to California for the annual almond bloom in February. For this reason, I avoid almond products, and in my gustatory opinion, Eastwind's cashew butter is the superior butter, hands down. Okay, let's get into it by starting with genus Bombus. Greek for buzzing sound, the Bombus genus is one of the few native North American species that is truly eusocial. Up until the 1920s, the familiar bumblebee was most often referred to as the humblebee, so dubbed by Shakespeare as well as Charles Darwin. Some popular articles in the 1920s refer to them as bumblebees, and the name has stuck. Bumblebees are able to use their powerful flight muscles to buzz-pollinate certain flowers that hold onto their pollen tightly. A common example are tomato flowers. You can hear bumblebees make short, loud bursts while on certain flowers during this process. Most of the released pollen will be collected from their hairy bodies and concentrated in storage areas on their hind legs, but just enough of this pollen will be floating around the bee to complete the plant's sexual life cycle as it flies to the next flower. The bumblebee species shown here have stable and perhaps increasing populations, in contrast to many other bumblebee and just generally other bee species in the United States. The honeybee is an invasive species brought to the New World in the 1600s in order to pollinate apple trees. The honeybee quickly spread across the continent and was known by indigenous peoples as the white man's fly, as its appearance would portend the white man heading west. Keeping honeybees in the Ozarks is made difficult primarily by the small hive beetle, to say nothing of varroa mites. These pests can destroy hives very quickly. Given the healthy native bee population in the area, pollination doesn't seem to be lacking as far as the garden is concerned. Tilothrix pomiformis, commonly known as the hibiscus bee, as is obviously appropriate here. This is one of many Apidae species that has evolved to efficiently pollinate particular flower species. And finally, Xylocopa virginica, commonly known as a carpenter bee. Its large size and loud buzz while flying give them away. Its dark wings and shiny abdomen contrast the bumblebee's hairy body and light wings. It is especially easy to find this bee because it seems just about all of them live in these cob benches underneath the lower herb garden pagoda. I have fond memories of reading Das Kapital while sitting amongst these buzzing delights when I first moved to Eastwind that sweltering first summer. Okay, that does it for the Apidae family. Moving on to the Megacalidae. This bee family is defined by zebra-like stripes and large mandibles, or jaws. Megacalidae means big-lipped family. Many species are specialists that target specific plants for pollen. The alfalfa leafcutter and blue orchard bee are two megacalids managed by agricultural interests for increased yields. Having robust and often cylindrical bodies, females carry pollen on the underside of their abdomens, unique to this family. And to end, we have a single representative in the largest genus of bees from the largest bee family, which is Andrenidae. This Andrena genus species is one of 1,400. If you can identify this particular species, you will certainly have a most blessed day. I hope you liked this little video. Maybe you learned a thing or two. Perhaps you enjoyed the beautiful pictures and melodious sounds of this sacred Ozark land. I want to end with a graphic that shows the differences between wasps, flies, and bees so that you can be aided in basic identification practice. After that, I will include some unseen photos and video footage that is demonstrably pleasurable to both ear and eye. Okay, so maybe you've noticed that flies have very distinct eyes that are larger typically and on top of their head. That's the biggest giveaway for me on flies. The bees are hairy typically and can be quite stout, whereas the wasps are more needle-like. Of course, there's no hard and fast rules. There's so many different species. Here's one that the internet couldn't identify. Is it a wasp? I don't know. Yes, hand-holding the camera can be tiring. I think you can identify this. Notice how it's collecting the pollen. Megacalid.
Excuse me, kind sir. You don't look so much a bit late for that pollen.
Forest. What it means is it means son of another far forest. Is what the word kind of translates to. But they had an active policy of recruiting, especially people who were brought into slavery in the Belt Hood in Africa. They would recruit them and help them stay.
Oh, does this look like a snake on it?
Yes, it does, kind of, but it's actually, those are actually garlic things.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Well, do you want to...